Choir, thank you, Angela. Thank you, Paul, for your scripture reading today. You see, when you join Trinity and you become a formal part of our family, we put you right to work. Of course, Paul has already put himself to work here and done quite a few projects around already, pressure washing our sidewalk, and if I remember to mention it at the end of the service, I would have mentioned it, but I'll go ahead and mention it now. But we're also looking at a digital announcement board, and that first draft, if you will, is in the fellowship hall on a television that you can take a look at and just give us any ideas. We're kind of thinking about placing it in that location, roughly where it is now. We've got a wall mount, but if you've got some better ideas, perhaps, on where to place it or on anything to do with that, please pass them along. We have reached the conclusion of our sermon series in God Speaks Through His Prophets. And we have seen, as I mentioned the last week, in kind of overviewing the series, seeing that one of the themes that flows through these series of sermons is that God calls His people. That God calls each of us individually and collectively as the church to accomplish God's mission. And one of the specific aspects that we've seen about this call, and that I think will be re-emphasized in Malachi's message today, is that God's call to us is a 24/7 call. Christianity and following Jesus and following God isn't simply a Sunday morning or a Wednesday night activity. It's a 7-day a week, 24-hour-a-day. And it's only when our worship here in this place becomes service out in our communities that we genuinely serve God. Being a Christian is not simply saying a prayer or believing certain things. It's all about action, about what we do with our lives. Now, it's become traditional, I understand, here at Trinity, to observe and remember the founding of this church during the month of June, frequently on the second Sunday of June, which happens to be today. Last year we had a more involved observance of Trinity Sunday, where we reaffirmed our commitment to Trinity's mission and vision statements. You may recall that we had it on the screen, and that at the end of the service, we had a candle area where you could come and light a candle to symbolize your commitment to Trinity's mission and vision. We're not doing that formally this year, but I did want to mention it today and see how it fit in again with this message from Malachi in the sermon. What good, or what's the use of serving God? Because that is what we seek to do as Trinity Baptist Church. Now, that mission and vision statement that we reaffirmed last year is in the middle of your bulletin every week, down at the bottom, underneath the sermon notes. And I'll go ahead and just highlight it and read it for you now. Trinity Baptist seeks to empower people to celebrate and affirm God's love for all by living as a courageous and generous community of whose love casts out fear, whose stewardship builds bridges of hope, and whose proclamation of Christ liberates others from injustice, oppression, and discrimination. Kind of in a nutshell, a way that I try and remember those words and seek to apply it, is that we as a church and as individuals seek to live God's love into the community around us. As we saw on Memorial Day, during that sermon on remembering those who gave the ultimate sacrifice for our country and Jesus Christ who gave the ultimate sacrifice for us, we saw that remembrance should transform the way we live. And if remembering doesn't transform the way we live, it's hollow and empty and worthless. So as we stand here or sit here today worshiping and reflecting on the history of the founding of Trinity Baptist Church by the charter members in 1984, 34 years ago today, if that remembrance doesn't change the way we live, then it's hollow and worthless. That's the message that the prophet Malachi had for his people and has for us today. You see, on a personal level, it's easy to ask the question, what's the use of serving God? We try and draw close to God. We try and obey God. We try and live God's love into the community around us. And yet, like the people in Malachi's day, we look around us and we see trouble. Maybe in our own lives, we struggle with prayers that we raise that seem to be unanswered. Maybe we look around our community, our country, and our world, and we see selfishness and corruption that seems to thrive. Financial executives that nearly brought our economy to its knees receive huge bonuses. Those of you who know me well know that I'm a baseball fan. And I look at players in baseball who cheated by using performance-enhancing drugs and now hold records. And are questioning, how should they be fully recognized? A recent survey by the Center for Academic Integrity revealed that 80% of college students have cheated on at least one test. Where is the reward for faithfulness and integrity? But you see, when we face these questions of unanswered prayer or of perhaps our faithfulness going unrewarded, we have to realize that life's bigger than we are. We'll talk about the life to come and the coming day of the Lord, that maybe there are things in the future we just don't understand, and God's faithfulness will be proven true then. But beyond the by, beyond the future, life's bigger than us right now. You see, doing the right thing takes practice. And every time we pray and go to God, we're learning to trust Him. Every time we don't lie on timesheets at work, every time we don't file false insurance claims or falsify our tax returns, every time we forgive our enemies and show them love as Jesus commanded, every time we choose God's way rather than society's way, we make the world a holier and a better place. How we act and what we do every day impacts those around us. When we do wrong or when we don't do right, there may be direct impacts on our loved ones and those close to us. But beyond the direct impacts, our example shines through. When people see us doing the right thing, when people see us not cutting corners, it makes the world a better place by setting an example for them. That's true for those of us in the workplace. It's especially true for those of us with children or grandchildren or other young people who look to us as examples. Life's bigger than we are. It's about more than just us. And as I alluded to earlier, the time will come when God will come and judge and bring complete righteousness. What we do today or don't do has an eternal cosmic impact. God will judge evil. The day of the Lord is coming, and we need to be ready for it. But we don't need to fear that day. As Malachi says, it can be a day that we rejoice, because our task is to faithfully and sincerely serve God, remaining true to His call, even when our efforts appear pointless. You see, that's the challenge, that's the difficulty faced by the people of Israel, the Hebrews, actually the people in Judah at the time, in Malachi's day. Malachi 1:1 introduces the book very simply, saying an oracle or a prophecy. The word of the Lord to Israel by Malachi. Nothing else is said about the prophet, about his call, about his background, about who he is. In fact, some people even question whether Malachi was the prophet's name, but the word Malachi means my messenger. In the Old Testament, God's messengers were often priests and, of course, prophets. The word from which Malachi comes from in the Hebrew is also translated angel, God's messenger. Most scholars believe that the prophet was speaking and writing sometime during the 5th century B.C., probably about 100 years after the Hebrew people were released from captivity in Babylon and had returned to Jerusalem, started to rebuild the city, rebuilt the temple, and were reestablishing the nation of Israel, reestablishing the southern kingdom that was known as Judah, that eventually, in Jesus' day, became Judea, the Roman region that we're familiar with in the New Testament. The Babylonian army, you may recall from some of our earlier sermons, had begun the exile around the turn of the 7th and 6th century, around 601 into the 590 BCs, and then eventually destroyed Jerusalem in 586 and took all of the remaining inhabitants into captivity in Lebanon. About the closest thing we can imagine to that utter destruction of the Jewish people and their homeland and their religious center, the temple, would be 9/11. And yet it pales, or what happened to the Jews pales when compared to 9/11. Their lives were completely wiped out. And then after 70 years or so in captivity, many of them were released and went back to Jerusalem and began to rebuild the city and the temple. You see, the prophet Isaiah had told the Hebrew people that they were going to be restored and that God would restore the nation and would bring His glory to the world through them. But the people were looking around, and it didn't look like those prophecies were being fulfilled. And so they questioned God, asking, "Are you a just God? Why does it appear that those who seek to do right are not being rewarded when those who do wrong are being rewarded? Don't you love us anymore, God? Don't you care for us anymore? And so that's the environment Malachi is writing in. And the whole book of Malachi is essentially an internal argument back and forth. A series of six specific arguments, or in the big theological word, disputation. Disputes between God and His people. Following the pattern where God makes a statement through Malachi, the prophet. That statement is followed by a question by the people, followed by God's response. And sometimes it goes back and forth for a while. Today's text includes the last of those discussions. The sixth one where God starts with the statement, "You have spoken harsh words against me." To which the people reply, "When have we spoken against you? We don't know what you're talking about, God." And then God responds, "You have said it is vain to serve God, or it is useless to serve God. What do we profit by keeping God's command, or by going through life as mourners before the Lord of hosts? When we look around and see the arrogant, happy, evildoers not only prosper, but when they put God to the test, they have sinned." So that's the question that was on the minds of the people. What use is it to serve God? And then God answers in the rest of our passage through chapter 4, verse 3. In the Hebrew text and in the Jewish scriptures today, there is no division between chapter 3 and 4. It's all chapter 3. That's really a pretty artificial break at 4. Because part of God's answer begins in chapter 3, verse 16, where Malachi says, "Then those who revered the Lord spoke with one another. The Lord took note and listened, and a book of remembrance was written in His presence." You see, faith is all about relationship. God has created us to relate with Him and to relate with each other. And what was going on in the Hebrews' lives during this time was they were going through the motions of worship. They were going through the motions of bringing sacrifice. They were going through the motions of bringing offerings and tithes to the temple, but their sacrifices were not heartfelt. In fact, their sacrifices in many cases were second rate. They were bringing diseased animals, animals who were not the best they had to offer. Malachi, speaking on behalf of God earlier in chapter 3, accuses the Israelites of cheating God, of robbing God of the tithe by not bringing sufficient support into the temple. But the crux of what's going on, not only was their worship insincere, not only was their worship incomplete, but their worship didn't reflect how they lived the rest of their lives. You see, they continued to oppress the powerless. They continued to take advantage of others for their own selfish gains, and so their worship was hollow. But those who were sincere in their worship got together, the prophet tells us in verse 16, and God listened. God took note, He listened, and He remembered. And there was recorded in all of their presence a book of remembrance. We don't know exactly what that book is, but this is carrying allusions, perhaps, to the book of life referred to in Revelation at the time of the final judgment. For, you see, the prophet goes on to say that those who revered the Lord and thought on His name shall be mine, says God. My special possession on the day when I act, and I will spare them the way a parent spares their children who serve Him. And on that day, we'll see the difference between those who serve God and those who don't serve God. For the prophet continues that you'll see the difference between the righteous and the wicked, the one who serves and the one who does not serve. You see, the day is coming. That's the chapter break. It really shouldn't be there. It's just a continuation. You'll see the difference. For the day is coming when all will be burned. The arrogant and all evildoers will become stubble. Those who burn shall be burned up, says the Lord, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. But the promise of hope is for those of you who revere my name, the Son of Righteousness. And that's S-U-N of righteousness, as the fire sang in the anthem. Shall rise with healing in its wings, and you shall go out leaping like calves from the stall. I'm not a farmer, I'm not a cow farmer, I haven't seen calves leaping from the stalls, but I have images of dogs and cats and all barnyard animals just leaping for joy because God remembers them. You see, last week we looked at this time of coming judgment, and it was more of a sober reminder that if we didn't follow God, there were consequences. And those consequences were judgment. And ultimately, destruction, for God has destroyed evil. He conquered evil on the cross. And most of all, on Sunday, when Jesus rose from the dead, and He's continuing to conquer today, looking toward that final day when there will be a new heaven and a new earth. And all will be as God intended it to be from the very beginning. Today's message from Malachi is really the flip side of that message from Nahum of judgment and potential risk of condemnation. Here, through the prophet Malachi, God is saying, those who revere my name, those who serve me, those who have acted righteously in accordance with my commandments during their lifetime, we stand. You see, there was a law during this time that when God came, all were going to be wiped out. No one's there. But God here is saying, if you belong to me, you'll be spared. And in fact, that heat of the flaming cauldron will be like the heat of the sun that will bring healing and peace and comfort. Now, that's probably the end of the book of Malachi, the prophet. When our scriptures were being compiled, there was added probably an appendix, which is verses 4 through 6. It doesn't really matter whether it's part of the original text or a later add-on, but I think it's helpful to understand the context of the book of Malachi and these last verses. You see, in the Hebrew scriptures, unlike the Christian scriptures, the book of Malachi is not the last book. Of course, we call the Hebrew scriptures what? The Old Testament. And Malachi is the last book in the Old Testament. In the Hebrew scriptures, Malachi is about 2/3 of the way through the scriptures. It closes out portion of Scripture known as the Torah, the first five books of the Bible we call the Pentateuch, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, given to Moses. And you see Malachi is making reference to that in chapter 4. Remember the teaching of my servant Moses, the statutes and ordinances I commanded him at Horeb for all of Israel. In other words, this closing portion of the law and the prophets that say, remember the law, remember the instructions, the Torah, the life-giving instructions that I, God, gave you, and in love, I will send you the prophet Elijah before the great and terrible day of the Lord's coming. So, remember my life-giving instructions, and then remember the prophets, symbolized by the great prophet Elijah. So this was a conclusion of the Hebrew Scripture, probably the Hebrew Scriptures as they were known at that time. Because there's a third part of the Hebrew Scriptures known as the writings. We call them things like Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. Actually, in the Hebrew Scriptures, Daniel belongs in that section, not in the prophetic section. Those scriptures were still being written and probably weren't finalized until shortly before Jesus came. So Malachi is a summary of the Hebrew Scriptures at that time. But of course, from a Christian perspective, Malachi provides a bridge from what we call the Old Testament into the New Testament. The messenger that God is sending, perhaps the Elijah that is being sent, is John the Baptist, who appears very shortly in Matthew. And then ultimately God's messenger, the beginning of the day of the Lord, Jesus Christ. I think that it's a bit over-presumptuous to see Malachi's words as directly foreshadowing John the Baptist and Jesus Christ, but that's the way the early Christians saw it, and I think there is some significance that we can get from that. But what matters most is that God is going to intervene in history, Malachi says. The day of the Lord is coming. And the day, in that day, God will set all things right. Those who belong to God will be rewarded, and those who don't will be destroyed. And those who follow the prophet Elijah, literally or symbolically, will turn from disobeying God and fighting parents and children, but will turn together so that God will come and bring healing, not destruction. So what does this remembrance of our mission as Trinity, what does this assurance of God that loyal, faithful service will be rewarded mean for us today? I'll close with a few possibilities for how we can live God's love in the world around us. How the day of the Lord that has come, is come, and is coming can change the way each of us live. One quick side note, the Hebrew word translated worship is the very same word also translated as service. You see, you can't worship God without serving God. We worship here and draw close to God so that we can serve God when we depart. And next week's sermon will pick up on that theme when we begin our series on Summer of Psalms Redux. In looking at Psalm 100, serve the Lord with gladness. And we'll be picking up on this idea of worship as opportunities that we have right now to serve and to live God's love into our community. As Renee said at the beginning of the service, tear out the final page of your bulletin and pray for those who need prayer. Pick up the phone and call those on the prayer list who may need a loving touch and tell them you're thinking about them. Get out a card and a note for those of us who still use pen and paper and send them a note. Or pull out your phone and send them a text or an email. Let them know somebody cares. And on the other side are our opportunities for service, a few of which I will highlight. Alex mentioned VBS, a VBS setup night a week from Wednesday, June the 20th. Come and be a part of that night. The very next Wednesday night will be the conclusion to VBS. Plans are still being finalized, but that's going to be a big celebration night. Come and be a part of that. Trinity Baptist Church can show it being a part of the 301 community by turning out that evening. In between those two nights, work in VBS. There's a place for you. You don't have to take primary responsibility for crafts or for teaching or for leading the singing, but you can come and be a helper and be a part of VBS. We need helpers in our student ministry, especially when the new school year starts and we promote some of our students and we restructure our classes again. God is calling each of us to do ministry for Him. To do something for Him in our daily lives. What has flown through all of these messages on prophecy, and Jesus is going to pick up when He comes to, following God is about action, not simply belief. Following God is about doing something for God, not just thinking about it. You see, the prophet Amos pulled it all together when he said, do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God. And I'll go ahead and below the closing, I misstated when I said it was Amos, that was Micah, who said, what God requires is do justice. Love kindness, and that's so important in this world we live in today. Cling to kindness and being an example of a kind, loving person, not a bitter, fighting person. But most of all, walk humbly with God. Join me in prayer. Lord God, Creator of heaven, earth and everything in heaven and on earth. We come to you thanking you that you do remember. You are a God who recognizes those who love you, those who seek to draw close to you and to be led by you. Lord, we confess we're not perfect. But Lord, we come together as groups that we call churches, just like that core body came together in 1984 to form what's now known as Trinity Baptist Church. Lord, we recommit ourselves to helping each other be better followers of you. Be with us as we leave this place. Help us to continue to prepare for Vacation Bible School. Help us to continue to prepare to live your love